And exercise is supposed to be good for you. And of course, the darling of the medical system for exercise was Jim Fix. He was a long distance runner. He was a professor of economics in one of the Ivy League schools. And he was the darling of the medical world because when he was interviewed on TV and asked if he took any vitamins and minerals, he says, nah, you don't need to do that. Don't take any vitamins and minerals. Just run, you'll keep your arteries clean. Well, he dropped dead while he was running a marathon at age 52. And so his theory didn't work. It was a failed theory. His protege, Brian Maxwell from Canada, died at 51 while he was running. He had 12 gold medals for long distance running. Three were in the Olympics. And he invented the power bar. And he sold the rights to the power bar to Nestle's corporation. And 3 months after he received his $3 million, he drops dead during a run. Cardiomyopathy, heart disease, a deficiency of a single mineral, just like Jim Fix. Now, because of this, the Journal of the American Medical Association did a literature review, which was published in December of 1982. In September of 1982, Jim Fix died, and they did this literature search because he was their hero, and they were just really freaking out because here we are, our hero dies of a heart attack while he's running. And they published it as a kind of letter to the editor thing in the Journal of the American Medical Association in 1982. And also, they published it later on as an abstract in Running World or Runner's World magazine. And they said, while running, a man's risk of heart attack death increases by 700% while running. Increased by a factor of 700%. Now, that shocked everybody because they thought exercise was good. Well, when you take all professional athletes of all sports combined and you look at them from an average lifespan, their average lifespan is 62. When you take out professional football players, their average lifespan is 51. There's never been a professional athlete ever lived to be 100. So what does that say to you about exercise? There's something problematic about exercise. It's not what it was led to you to believe it was. So what's going on here is when you sweat, you're not sweating out water. Sweat is not water. But yet athletes will go to great extents to rehydrate using water, or they'll drink these sports drinks that have two nutrients in them or six nutrients. And as a result, they begin to break down. They'll get torn cartilage in their knees, they'll get torn cartilage in their hips, they'll get torn muscles, torn tendons or Achilles tendon. They'll get cramps, they'll get all kinds of stuff. And they have to get taken off the field on the stretcher and so on. And then some of them die, okay, because they're sweating out all the nutrients floating around their blood. If they're not supplementing, they may only have 55 or 60 nutrients, which you're sweating out. If they're supplementing, they may have 90. But if you're not supplementing and you're exercising, you're in real trouble. Okay? Reggie Lewis, captain of the Boston Celtics, collapsed during a playoff game with the Charlotte Hornets. He survived that first cardiomyopathy heart attack, and he was given a drug to kind of support his heart function. And he was told to do light exercise, like throwing free throws from the free throw line on a court. And 2 weeks later, after his initial attack, he died of a second cardiomyopathy heart attack. If Reggie Lewis had been given 10 cents worth of selenium, he'd still be alive today, because he died of a simple selenium deficiency disease. Moses Malone, NBA Hall of Famer, dies at 60 of a cardiomyopathy heart attack. Roddy Piper dies at 61 from a cardiomyopathy heart attack. This fellow here, a cardiologist and a soccer star in Brazil, drops dead at age 57 from a cardiomyopathy heart attack. So why is it the strenuous exercise is unhealthy? Is because you must supplement to replace all the nutrients you're sweating out. Really, that's simple. Obesity, as we pointed out in the beginning, is not due to eating too much and lack of exercise. Obesity is, in fact, a simple nutritional deficiency. And there's no end in sight for the obesity epidemic because those nutrients are disappearing from our food faster and faster. The symptoms you get from that deficiency are cravings, binge eating, and the munchies. Experts tell us that 70% of our kids under the age of 12 are overweight. 40% of our kids under the age of 12 are obese, 30 pounds or more of their ideal weight for their height. And this has nothing to do with eating too much or lack of exercise. This is caused by nutritional deficiency, totally preventable, totally reversible quite quickly at a half a pound to 2 pounds a day. This is a kind of a false story. This is a false flag attack, so to speak. I guarantee this little baby who's under 2 years of age is not eating supersized bags of French fries. Not going to happen. But he is obese. And if he was eating these French fries and continued to eat them from then on, the odds are he would die of a coronary artery disease at age 10 or 12 years of age because of the trans fats, heterocyclamines, and the acrylamides in the French fries. He's obese because he's deficient in nutrients. Now, this is everywhere USA in 1920. This is when they began the theory that lack of exercise and eating too much was the cause of obesity. Of course, these girls are getting a lot of giggles here, but this has nothing to do with their cause of obesity or their repair themselves or getting rid of their obesity. They're going to have fun, they're going to waste some time, but they're not going to solve their problems here. It's a nutritional deficiency problem. Here's a mother in Brazil who ate 20 bath sponges with soap suds and skin dandruff in it, as well as the parrot droppings, as well as the sand in the bottom of the parrot cage, because she had such crazy cravings. Of course, pregnant women are legendary for gaining baby fat during pregnancy. That's because they're missing nutrients, because the embryo is stealing nutrients from them faster than they're getting them themselves. And this is Ivan, of course, met him about 3 years ago. And Ivan weighed 423 pounds when I met him. He lost, on our program, with our supplementation of nutrients, lost 17 pounds in the first week. He lost 60 pounds in the first 30 days. That's 2 pounds a day. And he dropped down from 400 pounds to 165 pounds in 7 months. And 2 years later, his picture's on the right. And he, of course, 2 years later, is still looking good and hasn't gained back a quarter of an ounce. And this is because this is a simple nutritional deficiency. You take the nutrients, it goes away. You take the nutrients, you don't get fat. Just that simple. In horses, the behavior called munchies is called cribbing. You can see here the horse is not even in that stall in the barn. It's a horse and buggy Amish farm in just south of Fort Wayne, Indiana. And the buggy's bringing the babies with muscular dystrophy late, and being a physician and a veterinarian, I said, well, there's a barn here. I'll go look at the animals. And sure enough, there's the cribbing evidence there. So I knew that that horse in that barn was deficient in minerals. You give them minerals and it stops. You give people the right minerals and the obesity goes away. It's just very simple. Osteoporosis and arthritis, simple mineral deficiencies, simple vitamin deficiencies. It's not a complex disease at all. It's a simple nutritional deficiency. Every tissue in our body, every organ in our body wants to go away. It's kind of like sand on a beach or paint on your house. Over time, getting beat up from the weather and the temperature changes and so forth, what happens is everything goes away. Well, if you're not taking in the raw materials to maintain it, like paint your house every year, right, that kind of thing, change your oil every 3,000 miles, you're going to have problems. And arthritis, and talking about the coming epidemic of arthritis, that's because we no longer have the right nutrients in our food anymore. We'll get into that in a moment. Now, colas are linked to bone breaks, fractures, because when you take in calcium for your bones, and oftentimes doctors will do that, you just give people calcium, you need all 90 essential nutrients for bone health, but if you're going to take in calcium along with the other nutrients, you have to have the right ratio between calcium and phosphorus. There's got to be 2 calcium for 1 phosphorus if everything's going to work well. If you drink colas, even diet colas, regardless of what brand of cola it is, guess what? You're going to have 4 phosphorus for 1 calcium. And that scenario is going to leach all the minerals out of your bones. And that's why you find a lot of young athletes get fractures just running down the field because they're drinking lots of colas. Calcium deficiency causes kidney stones. The first thing a medical doctor will tell you is stop eating dairy. And for goodness sakes, don't supplement with any calcium when, in fact, calcium deficiency is the cause of kidney stones. What happens is your parathyroid glands don't like that. They reach into your bones and they suck out minerals, particularly calcium. And that calcium that your parathyroid gland is pulling out of your bones raises your calcium level in your blood, as well as causes kidney stones. Failed medical theory. Popular osteoporosis drugs are linked to hip fractures. Why is that? You know, 1-800-BAD-DRUGS. Why is that? Because they were phosphorus. Fosamax, too much phosphorus, not enough calcium, and it causes demineralization of your bones. Another failed medical theory. Big surprise, another failed medical theory, is that osteoporosis is caused in women when they go through menopause because they don't have enough estrogen to keep calcium in their bones. That's an absolute lie. It's not true. Men actually get osteoporosis at a faster rate than women, more seriously and faster rate. You see all these little old guys with canes waddling around in the malls and airports and shopping centers and grocery stores and so forth. They have osteoporosis. And of course, this is a failed theory that women got it and men didn't because women went through menopause, had reduction, lost their hormones. That was a nonsense, absolute criminal theory, and somebody should go to jail for that one because they killed so many men who fell and had hip fractures when they should have been on mineral supplements to prevent that. This young fella here, the Prince of Dubai, Sheikh Rashid, died at 33 while he was running. You can see he's a very fit young fella. Runner, played soccer, played rugby, and he was held up as the kind of fitness guru in Dubai, kind of leading the country in their health. He was also a guy who was going to become the king when the king died. And he drops dead at age 33 while he was running, cardiomyopathy, heart attack, a simple deficiency of a single mineral. And so hopefully we're going to Dubai and to teach the people there that they have to supplement. No matter how wealthy you are, you still need to supplement to make sure your tissues are receiving everything they need. Terrible tragedy, terribly unnecessary. Andy Young from the Civil Rights Movement, also he was the ambassador of the United Nations under Jimmy Carter. He was the mayor of Atlanta for a couple of terms. And he called me from San Diego to come to Atlanta and in his home and speak to him because of my work in sickle cell anemia not being genetic. And we were talking about that, and I noticed he was limping. I said, with all due respects, Mr. Ambassador, why are you limping? He says, well, I got bone-to-bone arthritis in both my knees, and I'm scheduled at Emory University, the group that fired me for my cystic fibrosis research, to have a double knee replacement. I said, sir, with all due respect, I can regrow your cartilage. I can support and promote maintenance and repair by supplementing with a program we call the Healthy Bone and Joint Pack. And he said, well, these are the best surgeons, orthopedic surgeons in the world, and they say you can't. And I said, well, sir, with all due respect, they're liars. Okay, we can, in fact, support and promote maintenance and repair, and you will regrow your cartilage. And he didn't want to have the surgery, so he canceled the surgery and let me rebuild his knees. In 90 days, we rebuilt his knees, and we became very good friends, and we do lots of great things around the world together. One of the things he did was introduce me to this young lady, Delisha Jones. She was the center on the U.S. Women's Olympic team that had won 2 gold medals in the Olympics, the basketball team. And getting prepared for their third run at the Olympics, she tore her hamstring and Achilles tendon on the right-hand side. And the surgeons who were going to put her together said, Delisha, you know, we can put you together mechanically, but you might not play at the same skill level because of these injuries are very devastating. And you might consider coaching. Well, she didn't like that. She went to Andy Young, and he referred her to me. Again, using the Healthy Bone and Joint Pack, we're able to support and promote maintenance repair of the muscles and the tendons and ligaments and cartilage, regrew her, and they went back and won their third gold medal. And this is me giving her an award, a certificate for sharing her story with other athletes. And I often wonder, why do women who are 6'5" wear 8-inch heels? Okay, knee surgery for arthritis is worthless. This was a study from Harvard Medical School published in the New England Journal of Medicine. This was July 2002. And this is where we like to refer people. They looked at 300,000 sets of records from people who had knee replacement, hip replacement, shoulder replacement surgeries. They found out that the disease just kept getting worse and worse, and you had to replace that device every couple of years because the bone would get thinner and thinner and actually might tear and rupture and break. And so they said, ultimately, knee replacement surgeries for arthritis, hip replacements, and shoulder replacements are worthless. And so, you know, give us 90 days with a Healthy Bone and Joint Pack and let us support and promote maintenance repair and see what happens. You're going to be very happy because by supporting and promoting maintenance repair, we can support and promote repair and reappearance and regrowth of that cartilage. No matter what your doctor says, it's doable. 4 years later, November 2006, that same group of orthopedic surgeons from Harvard Medical School looked at the same 300,000 records, but this time they looked at the backs of these same people. They said back surgery unnecessary for sciatica, low back pain, for things like peripheral neuropathies. And so again, we can support and promote maintenance repair with what we call the Healthy Bone and Joint Pack. It has all 90 essential nutrients in it and gives the body the raw materials it needs to support and promote maintenance repair. Diabetes, there's an epidemic right now in the world. It's doubling. Diabetes is doubling almost every year now in America. Right now in America, 30% of Americans either have diabetes or pre-diabetes. It's breaking us financially. It's breaking the American medical system financially. Okay, it's breaking our country financially. It is one of the big contributing factors to the national debt of almost $19 trillion is type 2 diabetes. Why is there an epidemic? Because there's none of this mineral in the soil. Remember, it's a deficiency of a single mineral. We've known that for almost 80 years. The big story, to show you that it's not a genetic disease, goes to the Pima Indians. And above the line, where the line goes through the P and underneath the I under Pima, you see a big yellow band, looks like a big yellow banana there in the eastern part of Mexico. But above that line that goes through the P and underneath the I, you'll see it's the same genetic pool. That whole yellow area above that line, which is the border for Arizona, between Arizona and Mexico, mainland of Mexico. And below that border, you can see that big yellow swath. That is the range of the Pima Indians. They're one of the few Native American tribes that did not intermix with other Indian tribes. They did not intermix with the released black slaves after the Civil War was over. They never intermixed with the explorers from Spain and Portugal and France and Germany. And so they're almost pure, same genetic pool across the American border on the American side and below the American border on the Mexican side. And here's a couple of pictures of the Pima Indians, same genetic pool. Now remember, this is the exact same genetic pool. The group of young men on your left are Pima Indians. They're typical of those in Mexico. They're tall and slim. They live in a third world country situation. Don't have any of the amenities of the Western world. They're still using horses for plowing and wagons to haul stuff around, drawn by horses. And they look pretty good. The ones on the right are above the border in America, in Arizona. And you see they're all obese. Even the children are obese. And they have their vans and their pickup trucks and so forth. And they all work in factories instead of being subsistence farmers like the ones in Mexico. Let's have a look at the rate of diabetes. The Mexican Pima Indians have a rate of type 2 diabetes of 6%. The American Pima Indians, which are written up as the culture in America that has the highest rate of type 2 diabetes, 46%. The average American rate is considered like 33%, a third. And so they are 30% higher than that, 46%. Now, we know it's not genetic because it's the same genetic pool. So what could it be? Well, we know it's a mineral deficiency, but why? There's a thin line going between those two peoples, and yet there's such a difference between them. Why is this? And you'll see in just a moment. Again, diabetes cases double. Kids are being born with type 2 diabetes now. Not only type 1 diabetes, but they're being born with type 2 diabetes. And here's a 3.5-year-old, okay, from Houston. And she's 3.5 years of age, but she weighs as much as a 10-year-old. And she has type 2 diabetes. More blacks lose legs to diabetes than whites. This is one of those things where the black gene book comes in, black gene lies. More blacks lose a leg to diabetes than whites. Why is that? It's not a genetic thing. It's because the medical system has been able to capture the black community and tell them that all their diseases are genetic, and if they stick with the medical community, the medical doctors will save them from their genetic diseases. And so whatever the doctor says, they don't question it. They don't get a second or third opinion. They just do what the doctor says, and the doctor abuses them financially as well as kills them early. This fellow here, Jerry Murphy, owns one of the largest medical diagnostic labs in America, Gamma Labs. And he had terrible type 2 diabetes. He was running well over 200. His blood sugar was running well over 200. His A1C hemoglobin was like 9 or 12 instead of 5 or below. And to make a long story short, we made a wager because we had a mutual friend who said I could help him with his diabetes. And he's very skeptical, of course, working with the medical community. And he says, look, Wallach, we'll be best friends. We'll do a lot of good things for America together if you can do what you say. If you can't, I will destroy you. I'm going to make a CD. I'll have bounty hunters pass them out everywhere you go, and I will dog you until you're destroyed if you fail. He said, okay, Jerry, you're on. He was quite shocked that I so quickly said, okay, let's do it. Well, to make a long story short, in 3 months' time, his A1C hemoglobin was below 5, and his blood sugar was down to like 90, or had been running 240. Okay, and he's now totally diabetes-free. He's a wonderful friend, and we just love him to pieces because he does great things for us too. Cancer is not a genetically transmitted disease. It is a self-inflicted disease. Everything you do either prevents cancer or causes cancer. And so let's have a look. Doctors and researchers, they're so interested because it's such a horrible disease, they want to run in and get the cure right away. And they fail every time to find the cure. The first prevention research was done and published in 1912. It was on the benefits of selenium in preventing cancer. They published it in Popular Mechanics magazine. Now, why did they publish something like that in Popular Mechanics magazine? That's because they brought it to all the medical journals of the day, and they wouldn't publish it. That's nutrition. We're not interested in that. That was 1912. Well, in 1998, the University of Arizona redid the same study, redid it, got the same exact results, showing they could reduce the risk of prostate cancer by 65%, 69%. You reduce the risk of breast cancer by 32%, reduce the risk of colorectal cancer by 95% by supplementing with selenium. Published it in the Annals of Medicine, which is a very well-respected medical journal. High-fiber diets don't cut colon cancer rates. That's another failed theory. Bacon, ham, sausages are a big cancer threat, equal to smoking and working in an asbestos environment. Now, I've been yelling about this for 45 years since I did those autopsies in the Center for the Biology of Natural Systems. And the World Health Organization 2 weeks ago made the announcement. The World Health Organization will publish a report on Monday, which was 2 weeks ago, on the dangers of eating processed meats. The World Cancer Research Fund has warned for several years that there is strong evidence that consuming a lot of processed meats, such as ham, bacon, and salami, increases the risk of colon cancer and many other types of cancer, okay? They also say that, probably all red meat causes cancer. That's not true. It's how you cook the red meat, okay, will be a factor. This was a study published in 1998 from the University of South Carolina, and they were working on the Harvard Nurses' Health Study, 90,000 nurses, 20 years, and their piece was to evaluate the rate of breast cancer in women and how they cook their food. Okay, they're getting down into that area of interest. Well, they found out that the women who cooked their meat very well done, where the fat was severely browned or burnt, increased their risk of breast cancer by 462%. The ones who cooked their meat medium rare and the fat remained white reduced the risk of breast cancer by 462%. So that's a 900% difference between the most extreme you're going to get it to the most extreme you're not going to get it. And what a wonderful thing. Just how you cook your food determines whether you're actually going to get breast cancer or not. And then there was some wonderful research by Dr. Gerhard Schrauser, great biochemist from University of California, who showed very clearly that you could reduce the risk of breast cancer by 82% just by supplementing with 200 micrograms, one-fifth of a milligram of the trace mineral selenium. Remember he said mammograms are not prevention, and they're dangerous because one mammogram has a radiation equal to 500 chest x-rays. Also, we find out that, and this is very recent, in October of 2015, 61% of all positive mammograms are false positives. And they say, you know, we just, this is too complicated here, so we have to have a biopsy, get a biopsy. You know, this is unequivocal, but we're concerned, and so let's take the breast off and do radiation and chemotherapy. So they get their hit in, they bill the insurance company or Medicare, Medicaid for $200,000, and the doctor is happy, kills the patient. Hot dogs cause butt cancer. This is directed towards kids. These are highway signs you'll begin seeing on the highways around America. Genetics have nothing to do with cancer, It's eating fried foods, processed meats with nitrates and nitrites cause the problems. Arsenic is known to be an essential nutrient since 1947, and today even the medical school at the New York University proved unequivocally that they could put people with acute promyelocytic leukemia, the most vicious, the most aggressive type of leukemia, into remission in just a couple of months. And 10, 12, 15 years later, they're still in remission. They didn't want to call it a cure because it's an essential nutrient. Steve Jobs dies at 56. Satoru Iwata, CEO of Nintendo, dies at 55. His parents buried him at age 55. Dementia, there's five different types of dementia. There's no law that says you can't have all five. Vascular dementia, arteries are clogged in your brain. Same way they're clogged in your heart and your kidneys. Alzheimer's disease, a cholesterol deficiency. Korsakoff syndrome, a deficiency of a single vitamin. Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome, which is the deficiency of that single vitamin and also MS mixed in with it, multiple sclerosis. Vitamin B12 deficiency, dementia, you can have all five of these at the same time, okay? Now remember, Alzheimer's disease is caused by a cholesterol deficiency. It is not genetic, not caused by aluminum. This is my favorite slide on Alzheimer's disease. The mother is 82 years old, the son's 58, they both have Alzheimer's disease, they're both in the same nursing home. They both have the same doctor, they're on the same cholesterol-restricted diet, and they're on the same statin drug prescribed by that doctor. The doctor also owns the nursing home they're in. You should be getting a picture here. Somebody needs to go to jail. This came out in 1992, and this is one of the reasons that my original audio cassette tape, Dead Doctors Don't Lie, was so controversial. Vitamin E can ease memory loss in Alzheimer's victims. And I added a prepositional phrase when I read this. This was research from the Salk Institute and the University of California, San Diego. Vitamin E may ease memory loss in Alzheimer's victims, which means it cannot be genetically transmitted. Because there's no vitamin, there's no pharmaceuticals can affect how a genetic disease manifests itself. 2 years later, the Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, very famous, very well respected in Baltimore, Maryland, went to the Cache Valley, Utah, And they found 5,000 people over the age of 65 who had no dementia, no serious disease, no heart disease, high blood pressure, kidney disease, nothing. And so they found them. They put them on two vitamins, vitamin C and vitamin E, because they were excited about this vitamin E story that came out 2 years earlier. And 10 years later, again, they had half these 5,000 people on this supplement, and the other half they put on a dummy pill. At the end of the 10 years, 2004, they opened up the envelope and undid the map. And the ones that got the vitamin C and E had 78% less Alzheimer's disease. Now, they all ate the same way, because they're all from the same culture. They all came from Scotland. All these 5,000 people came from the same religion. They were Mormons. They read the Book of Mormon. They were also using the supplement called the Words of Wisdom, which tells them what to eat, what not to eat, kind of like the Jewish kosher approach. And so there's more to it than just those two vitamins. Also, they were all subsistence farmers, much like Amish, very, very basic, very conservative farmers, only ate what they grew, no restaurants or hotels in their valley where they lived. And so we actually had an analysis done of the floor of that entire valley. We know all the mineral veins and everything, what's in there. And so in the book Epigenetics, it goes into great detail why these people had such a wonderful reduction in the rate of Alzheimer's disease just by supplementing those two vitamins, vitamin C and E, because they enhance the value and function of other things is why. Type 2 diabetes has got to be genetic because we have three generations of type 2 diabetics in our family. No, that's not true. Have you ever heard of gluten intolerance? Gluten intolerance is generational. It's not genetic. It's not an allergy, but it is generational. And it causes eczema, dermatitis of all kinds, belly problems, belly pain, headaches, all kinds of nasty stuff. Celiac disease, appendicitis, diverticulitis, irritable bowel syndrome, inflammatory bowel disease, Crohn's disease, asthma, chronic bronchitis, pneumonia every wintertime, eczema, rosacea, dermatitis, psoriasis, infertility. It can contribute to 1,000 other diseases because these other diseases are nutritional deficiencies. And gluten intolerance changes the efficiency of absorption out of your intestines. If you can't absorb the nutrients, you have a problem. But let's talk about type 2 diabetes. And you only have 2% of the mineral you need to prevent diabetes in the soil where you're living and you're eating from local farmers markets. And now you have a gluten intolerance and you only have 10% of your availability of absorption. So what's 10% of 2%? 0.2%. You're going to get diabetes. It has nothing to do with genetics. And here is the villi, those little red finger-like projections on the left-hand side of your screen. And these villi increase the absorptive surface of the intestine. Well, here's a study in white rats. On your left-hand side are the healthy villi. You can see the little villi. This is a microscopic picture, obviously. The normal ones, you can see all the increased surface for absorption. In the middle picture, those same group of rats were put on a heavy gluten diet for 6 months. You can see the loss of the villi and the scar tissue beginning to form in between them. On the right-hand side, it's a year of a heavy gluten diet. And you look at all the scar tissue. They've lost almost 100% of their villi. And the intestinal lining is replaced with scar tissue. How do you absorb nutrition through there? You can't. And this is what gluten does to you. It's kind of like putting poison ivy on your skin. You get a contact dermatitis. With gluten, you get a contact enteritis. Okay, and inflammation in the intestines caused by this protein, which is very, very irritating. Okay, now the nice thing about this is, if a 10-year-old kid or a 3-year-old kid or a 6-month-old kid gets on a gluten-free diet, in a couple of weeks' time, you're gonna see a dramatic benefit, particularly if you're giving them the 90 essential nutrients. Let's say somebody in their 20s and 30s and 40s gets on a gluten-free diet. Within a month, you're going to see something dramatic in a positive way, and it might take them a full year to repair. People who are in their 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s have been eating gluten 5 times a day and oatmeal for breakfast every day, drinking a couple of beers every Friday night, and having bread and pasta and crackers and gluten and whole grains all the time. It might take them 2 years to get a return to normal on a gluten-free diet, but they might show some dramatic thing you can see as a benefit within maybe 6 months. Just depends on how long and how severe the gluten damage is. Here's a perfect example. Little Yusi on your left was born with eczema and asthma. His mother was born with the same eczema and asthma. She's 28 years old when she delivered him. She'd had 3 miscarriages, and she had the same eczema and asthma, and she's breastfeeding him. So we gave her a gluten-free diet. We put her on the 90 essential nutrients, 16 minerals, 16 vitamins, 12 amino acids, 3 fatty acids, and in 2 weeks' time, her asthma or eczema she'd had for 28 years went away. In the same 2 weeks, you see in the middle there, his asthma and eczema went away in 2 weeks' time because he's getting all his nutrients through his mother's breast milk. Now, Interesting thing about this, the pediatrician who's caring for him, the only thing he told the mother was, here's some hydrocortisone cream, rub it on his skin to prevent the itching. And also, I told her to clip his fingernails and put mittens on his hands so he wouldn't scratch himself in his sleep. Well, here he is on the right at 2 years of age, and you can see how happy he is. You can tell by looking at him, he doesn't have asthma and eczema. We see this all the time in kids, and the ones on the left have their eczema, dermatitis, psoriasis, and the ones on the right, they've been without gluten for anywhere from a month to 6 months, and they're getting the 90 essential nutrients. You can see the difference, very dramatic. This lady was this way for 23 years. Her dermatologist made $3 million treating her for 23 years. And of course, in 90 days, gluten-free diet, 90 essential nutrients, this is all reversible. Longevity, 1 in 5 Americans are disabled. 20% of Americans are disabled. We're supposed to have the finest medical system in the world. We don't. We have the most expensive medical system in the world, but it's problematic. Remember that 85% of all personal bankruptcies in America are due to medical bills. This just shows you the prevalence. It's the same pattern in the continental United States. It's always the south eastern states. It's always the Atlantic border there. We run up and down the Atlantic Ocean, and also the states around the Great Lakes. Also the southwestern states and up in the northwest where they have Indian tribes. It's the worst of the worst when it comes to disabilities here. Okay, and this is cancer. Here's one a little bit of departure. The state that has the worst cancer rate is Kentucky. And of course, the reason why they have such terrible cancer is there's very few of the minerals in the Atlantic seaboard. There's very few of these minerals in the south eastern part of the United States, the old Confederate states and the Indian reservations out west. There's one particular state, they fry everything. Kentucky, they fry everything. It's rumored they fry water, and that's why they have such a high rate of cancer. Life expectancy, the red, yellow, and orange are the shortest live, and the ones in the blue counties are the longest lived people. There's a 25-year difference between the longest lived people and the shortest lived people in America simply because of the mineral supply in their soil, where their food is grown, and whether or not they fry food. The ones in the blue don't fry food, and the ones in the reds and orange and yellows do. West, southwest, west of the Mississippi River, Indian reservations, old Confederate states, in the southeastern part of the United States and eastern seaboard. Same thing for males. Statin drugs speed up aging process. Women go through menopause in their 30s. Low TED in males, regardless of age. Alzheimer's disease, we're now finding in 30-year-olds and 20-year-olds, because it has nothing to do with age, nothing to do with genetics. It has to do with a cholesterol deficiency. If you're very, very good, like vegetarians, vegans, who are really driven to stay away from animal products and cholesterol and saturated fat, and they take statin drugs, many of them, not all, but many of them, and they're the ones who have a high rate of Alzheimer's disease and hormonal problems. So I urge everybody to get a hold of these books, Black Gene Lies, Epigenetics, Immortality, and Rare Earths Been Cures, and you'll learn why the top 20 longevity cultures live so long. What are their secrets? They have 23 common threads, and of course, I'm going to show you what I believe are the more important ones after this, after these pictures. But I want you to look at Immortality. Look at the cover of that book. I want you to look at the top picture above that yellow line, just below the neck of that statue there. It's a fire. I want you to pay attention to that fire because this is very, very important in why the top longevity cultures, the top 20 longevity cultures are all third world cultures. Calorie restriction diets, these same top 20 longevity cultures only take in 600 to 900 calories a day, not because they know the science, they're illiterate, they're third world cultures. But they're so poor they can only afford 600 to 900 calories a day. Americans take in 2,500 to 4,000 calories a day. This fellow here, George Francis, died at 112 in December of 2008. He was the longest lived documented man in America. He lived considerably longer than 19 presidents he lived through, whose average lifespan was 75. The doctors who cared for these presidents documented their average lifespan came out in 1999 in a big study published in medical journals. It's 56, exactly half of the years that George Francis got. Now, he lived in a house. It was a cabin that his great-granddaddy built during the slave days. A pot-belly stove, dirt floor. It was a crawdad fisherman and fisherman. Sold those things to restaurants, Cajun restaurants. And he lived to be 112. Double the lifespan of medical doctors who took care of presidents. So what was the secret? When he died, his daughter was asked by the reporters, and his daughter was reading the newspaper to him there. The daughter said, when she was asked, what did your daddy do to live to be 112? She said, he broke all the rules of healthy eating. He cooked in lard and ate butter and cream and eggs. In fact, she said his entire diet was dairy products, eggs, and lard sandwiches. Also on the right-hand side, you see the Russian Mismalov, 168 years of age, is a very famous picture in the National Geographic where he is working in his tea plantation and also listening to a transistor radio at 168 years of age. Man from Syria, died at 133 years of age. National Geographic cover, May 2013, this baby will live to be 120. Look at the grammar there. This baby will live to be 120. She's from the Nicoya Peninsula on the Pacific coast of Costa Rica in Central America, one of the poorest of poor countries and cultures on Earth. Okay? These are the longest-lived people in the Western Hemisphere. What's going on here? Why do they have 40 times 100 as we do? Why do they have 100 per 250 of their population? We Americans only have 100 per 10,000. This fellow's from Bolivia, the second longest-lived culture in the Western Hemisphere. He's putting llama manure in his wood stove. There's a high-tech kitchen. He's 102. This fellow here is from Florida. When he turned 101, he actually got a hole-in-one on his 101st birthday. We need to find out what he does and make sure that Tiger Woods gets the information. These are the longest-lived people on Earth, the Hunzas from the Hunza Valley in the Karakoram Mountains that separate northern Pakistan from China. They're the longest-lived people on Earth. They live at 13,000 feet elevation, and they're descendants of Alexander the Great when he moved east from Greece after he won all the battles there. He moved east towards China and, of course, having babies along the way. These people live at 13,000 foot elevation. You can see they're obviously third world. And they live in what we would call the land flowing with milk and honey. The Giltar Glacier, which is about a mile wide at 13,000 foot elevation, okay? The water that comes out from underneath the Giltar Glacier looks like milk because the glacier is grinding up limestone. And so the limestone powder comes out in the water and it looks like milk. And bees love minerals, and so there's lots of bees there. The land flowing with milk and honey. This is biblical. This is a biblical location. This is where people did well. They were successful in business. They were healthy. They lived a long time, had healthy children. In Okinawa, it's not all Okinawas live well or long. It's only a very small group of people up in one mountain, on the side of one mountain. They live to be an average of 85. Everybody else lives to be 52 to 60. So it's not all of Okinawa that lives well, it's just one little subculture. Now the reason is, of course, we'll get into in a second. We spent a lot of time with this fellow here, Mr. Taguchi, who's 102 years old, and he lives in this little subculture up on the side of this mountain, and so we know exactly what they do to live so long. And here's the oldest gal up there. She's a pop star. She goes around with a singing group, and she's the lead singer in a singing group singing pop songs, and you can just tell by looking at her, her energy is just tremendous. She's from the island of Kohama in Okinawa. In the last 300 years, this is the longest lived of humanity that's documented. Dr. Yun, Ching Yun Li, and Chinese always put their last name first, so Ching Yun Li, died at 256 years of age. He was born in 1677, died May 6, 1933. And he lives in a place that is rich with rare earths. In laboratory animals, rare earths double the lifespan of laboratory animals compared to the control group. Okay, we use them in electronics. We know they're very valuable for electronics, but also they're required. Ytterbium, yttrium, neodymium, praseodymium, europium, and samarium. And of course, they're all in the 90 essential nutrients and all 60 essential minerals. We need water for life. We need oxygen for life. You need the 90 essential nutrients for life. Your DNA, RNA, your genes, your telomeres, little end caps on your chromosomes will fail without these nutrients. You have to have them every second, every minute, every hour, every day, every week of every month of every year. Otherwise, you're going to have problems. It's just that simple. You cannot live without them. You need 16 minerals, 16 vitamins, 12 amino acids, 3 fatty acids. You have to have them. Your genes, your DNA, RNA, and telomeres must have these things. Otherwise, you can have the greatest genes in the world, but they're not going to perform. This is when I first understood epigenetics. Epigenetics has replaced genetics when it comes to the understanding of disease and longevity. This was a study we did at the St. Louis Zoo when I was doing all those autopsies back in the 1960s and 70s and ended up in that book, which is in the Smithsonian Institute, The Disease of Exotic Animals. And Monsanto gave the St. Louis Zoo, because we're in the newspaper all the time because of these studies going on, gave the St. Louis Zoo a timed hydroponic unit. Had these big racks with all these trays and had seeds from barley grass and on a timer it would water and fertilize this. And we would be able to harvest this like weekly. It was just wonderful for the zoo animals eating dry food and hay all the time, no green grass. It's really a wonderful thing. And Perkins, who was from the St. Louis Zoo, obviously, and the TV show, okay, Mutual Omaha's Wild Kingdom, said, okay, Wallach, find out of what real value is this hydrogen? Is it just fun for these animals? Are we just, you know, wasting our time, or is it useful for them? And so I was able to steal eggs from the same mother father, common mallard ducks, farm ducks. I stole 100 eggs over a period of 3 months, put them in the refrigerator, just like you can put human frozen embryos in the freezer. Just put them in the refrigerator. When I had 100, I divided them into four groups of 25. The first group of 25, I just gave lettuce to eat for 6 weeks. The second group of 25, I gave nothing but the hydroponically grown barley grass. And you can see it's about 10, 15%, maybe even 20% bigger than the ones that just got the lettuce. The one in the middle with the little scale or the little ruler on it received the Ralston Purina Laboratory duck pellets. See, it's double the size of the other two. But the one that really got optimal amounts of every nutrient it needed to maximize its genetic potential for size and strength and everything it can do was what we call the Huey group. It got both the pellets, the alfalfa pellets from Ralston Purina, and the barley grass. Look at the difference. They're the same exact genes, same mother, father, incubated at the same time, and so there's no doubt that this is an epigenetic story here. In that study, the Center for Biology of Natural Systems, we eliminated 900 different diseases in animals which still plague people. Because we realized there were nutritional deficiencies, we increased the nutritional supplementation of zoo animals and eliminated all the diseases. And of course, this is what saved the panda. The pandas were down to just maybe a dozen pandas left in zoos, and they were about ready to all die out. And then suddenly, we heard about Ling Ling, right? And suddenly, we had all these other baby pandas. What's happening? I finally got to do an autopsy on one of them, and it was just starving to death because we're feeding it nothing but bamboo. And so I said, let's give them some dog food. Oh, you can't. This is an exotic animal. You can't give them dog food. So we gave them dry dog food, and now we have more pandas. We know what to do. They got to give them birth control, okay? We've tripled the lifespan of animals with this information. And basically, if you look back 60 years ago, an old dog was 8 years old, 10-year old dog is 25. In the same time span, we humans have added 2 or 3 months to our lifespan. We didn't triple it like we did for animals because we're using drugs and we use nutrition for animals. We eliminate every birth defect you can name and 10 times that many you can't in animals by supplementing preconception. And I urge everybody, when you're getting a couple that's dating strong, a couple that's getting engaged, or a couple that's getting married, do not give them a gift card. Do not give them monogram towels. Do not give them a linen set to start their household. Give them the 90 essential nutrients, and then you won't be a grandmother babysitting a special needs child. How did rich people get their minerals back thousands of years ago? They'd give grave robbers big bags of silver and gold to get mummies and bring them mummies. They grind up the mummies into mummy dust, and they would use mummy dust as a condiment like salt and pepper on their food. They're getting the minerals from the mummies' bones and skin and vitamins from their livers and so forth. They did get some supplements that way, and they lived longer and healthier. Now, obviously, people who were slaves and subsistence farmers and people who were just carpenters couldn't afford big bags of gold and silver to get mummies. Where'd they get their minerals? Well, the Scientific American did a wonderful story on why people began to live longer, were healthier, were smarter, did things, invented language and so forth, invented writing. And they said it was all because of cooking food. It all happened when food began to be cooked. That's exactly right, but it wasn't because of the cooked food. But it began when food was cooked, but not because of the cooked food. Now, what was the universal fuel 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 years ago? Wood. No matter where in the world they burned fuel for heat, for cooking, for defense, whatever it was, the fuel was always wood. And what did they do with the wood ashes every morning? They throw them in the recycling bin to save the earth. Where did the wood ashes go? They went into the garden. Wood ashes aren't ashes. 95% to 98% of the wood ashes are really minerals that the trees sucked up out of the ground when you burnt the wood. That powder that's left is minerals. Sometimes it's a little gray or black because there's some carbon left over, but 95 to 98% of what we would call wood ashes are really minerals that the tree had sucked up out of the ground. We threw it in the garden, and everybody knew it increased the fertility. You had better yield, and your gardens did better when you put wood ashes in there. But what they didn't know, and yet today they don't know, and I'm depending on all of you to share this information, what they didn't know and they don't know today is those plants sucked up those minerals. When you ate the pumpkins and the squash and the okra and the tomatoes and the bell peppers, and you ate the potatoes and the onions and the peas and beans and lentils and corn that were grown there, they sucked up all those minerals. And that's how you got your minerals. You didn't know you were getting your nutritional minerals that way, but you did. This remained the same for thousands and thousands and thousands of years until 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Monday, September 4th, 1882. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, Monday, September 4th, 1882, on Pearl Street in New York City, on the bluff overlooking the construction of the Brooklyn Bridge, it all ended in a single heartbeat. We know this because the story was in every newspaper in the world. This fellow here, Thomas Edison, pulled the switch on the first commercial electric generating plant. Within 10 years, every industrialized nation, including the United States, every town and every city in every industrialized nation converted from wood as the universal fuel to electricity. Here comes the ultimate question. How many wood ashes are left over in your home every morning when you use electricity to fuel your home? Zero. Zero. Now, nobody knew what was happening. They still don't. And again, the most fertile and the most valuable farmland in the world thousands of years ago and yet today are floodplains, because every spring it would flood, and as the water would recede, it would leave silt and mud behind, minerals, if you will, from mountains hundreds or maybe thousands of miles upstream. And people like this, of course, they'd plow this in and renew the mineral content of the soil, because when you have minerals in the food, it's because the plants are pulling minerals out of the soil. They don't know it. They don't need it. They only need three, but they'll take up anything that's soluble in the soil. People liked it. Guess what? Today we have 900,000 dams for hydroelectric power. 900,000 dams for hydroelectric power. And of course, there was an unintended consequence, flood control. Now, people thought that was good at first. They didn't realize that we destroyed the earth with flood control, because there's no renewal of the minerals in the soil, the farmlands, or the plains, or where it was flooding, the valleys. And we've shut off the food supply to ourselves. We've shut off our minerals for ourselves, as you'll see in a moment. We have exact numbers by the U.S. Department of Agriculture. So things are happening. It's all negative because we've dammed up the rivers. We've cut off the food supply to our farms. We've cut off the food supply to the ocean. It's over 100 feet deep of minerals that have piled up since they built the Hoover Dam. Nutritional minerals do not occur in a uniform blanket around the crust of the earth. Nutritional minerals occur in veins like chocolate and chocolate ripple ice cream. Some places have little, some places have none, some places have three minerals, some places have 15, some places have 25, some places have 40. But you can see from this picture, which is a satellite picture from 100 miles up, that the different colors and the swirls and whorls represent different minerals and different combinations of minerals. So in the animal industry, so every dairy cow is eating hay or beans, soybeans grown in this area, we would put a supplement of vitamins and minerals in their alfalfa pellets, maybe grown there. Are there soybeans grown there? So we put the vitamins and minerals in their food, so we're leveling the playing field. So every dairy cow, no matter what part of that picture she got her food from, she's going to give us a maximum yield, say a gallon and a half of milk, instead of 10% of the cows giving a pint and 20% giving a quart, instead of all 100% giving a gallon and a half. It's predictable. It's also very nutritional, because a lot of these minerals appear in the milk, if they're there. If they're not there, obviously the cow can't make them. Now, this is what makes longevity unique. This is a compost pile. This compost pile goes back into prehistoric days. It's made out of 100% green leafy plants. We know this because of the chloroplast, the little chlorophyll structures inside of plants, green leafy things. And they contain 78 minerals, all 60 essential minerals in optimal amounts. These people are standing on a road that's 3,000 foot elevation above sea level. That white cap on this deposit is 15 to 25 foot thick, and it represents a cap of marine limestone. So obviously it was under the sea for thousands and thousands and thousands of years to make this limestone. And there's 100 cubic miles of this stuff here in this deposit. 100 cubic miles. We know this from drillings and soundings because, oh gosh, 50, 75 years ago, people are looking for oil. They're looking for coal. They're looking for natural gas in these places. And they said, what is this stuff? This isn't what we're looking for. And they just deserted it. Of course, this is something that is incorporated into our 90 essential nutrients, getting the 60 essential minerals from this deposit. We knew in 1936 our soil was depleted of minerals. This is U.S. Senate Document 264, and it was a two-year hearings done by the U.S. Senate to determine why our soils were dead. Why did we have the Dust Bowl? Why did we have the Great Depression? They blamed it on depletion of minerals in the soil in 1936, but nobody proposed the reason why our soil was depleted. If you ask even yet today environmentalists, professors of agriculture at big agricultural universities, you ask them, why is our soil so depleted of minerals? They'll always say because of poor farming practices. That's not true. Nothing has changed as far as farming practices. We plow, we plant, we harvest. We plow, we plant, we harvest. And so what is it? Well, no more wood ashes in the gardens, no more silt from floods, and we've cut off the food supply to our land. We've cut off the food supply to our oceans. That's why we're in trouble. This is one that really disturbs me. Our baby food, according to the Food Chemistry Journal, which comes out every month, I read it faithfully every month, and this one came out April 16, 2012. They looked at the top 8 baby formulas. From the standpoint of pollution and from nutritional value, they said, these baby formulas, we're talking about Enfamil, Similac, Gerber's, ones you're very familiar with, very well respected. These baby foods contain less than 20% of the required nutrients needed for proper development of our babies. We're talking about 20% of the minerals and vitamins our babies need is all you're going to get in giving them these baby foods. If you don't supplement, you're going to wind up burying them, like Joe Biden buried his son, Beau. Steve Jobs' mother buried him, and Iwata's mother buried him. Okay, you're going to wind up burying your children if you don't supplement them because it's not in the food anymore, even from the very beginning. Okay, these baby formulas. You must supplement. We do it in animals. We got great results. We have to do it in people. We're going to have to do this. The government has failed us, and guess what? The medical system has failed us terribly, and somebody needs to go to jail. This is a 100-year study from 1914 to 2014. And, of course, they referred back to U.S. Senate Document 264 published in 1936. Our farm soils are depleted of vital minerals, and as a result, our foods are literally starved of nutrition. Medicine cannot compensate for this deficiency. U.S. Senate Document 264, 1936. And the minerals in our soil over the past 100 years, 1914 to 2014, have been depleted by 85%. You can see the chart and the graph on the right. You can see the extreme dip in the mineral values of our soil. Okay. Then in the bottom line, and again, this comes from last year, 2014, USDA, the United States Department of Agriculture, reports that 95% of all Americans are minerally deficient. What more do you need? What more do you need to understand that you must supplement? No matter how well you eat, you're a billionaire, it doesn't matter. You're an athlete, it doesn't matter. If you're a farmer, it doesn't matter. If you don't supplement, you're in trouble. Worse yet, if you don't supplement and supplement your children are in trouble. Remember, experts are saying that our children will be the first generation of Americans that do not live as long as their parents. To me, that's very, very scary, but we have the power, we have the knowledge to fix this. But we're going to have to be very proactive here because the government's not going to do it, and guess what? The doctors aren't going to do it. I want you to look at these maps of the United States again, but I want you to look at the demographics here. Look at the worst of the worst, and here are the dark blue, okay? This is disability rates. Look at the dark blue ones, which is the worst of the worst. 31% in the dark blue states of disability. Look at this one. And this one, you look at this one, this is the heart age compared to the actual chronological age. The ones in the dark burgundy are the worst of the worst. Same demographic. Look at this one. Heart disease. Same demographic. Southeastern states, the old Confederate states, the states in the Great Lakes area and west of the Mississippi River, the Indian reservations in the northwest and the southwest. Okay, and now we're going to look at cancer. Same thing, old Confederate states, the states around the Great Lakes and the Northwest and the Southwest where the Indian reservations are. Eastern seaboard, worst of the worst. Yeah, life expectancy, as you would expect, with all these terrible diseases being the worst in those places, same demographics. The blue areas, this is by county, actually live 25 years longer than the ones in the orange and the yellow and the red, both in the old Confederate states, the Great Lakes areas, out west, Northwest and the Indian reservations in the Southwest. This is both for males and females. The way we've been doing this for 38 years, and we've been doing this commercially for 38 years, is to supplement with all 90 essential nutrients. And of course, we have 1,000 products, and it's very difficult for a stranger to come along and look at all and say, oh my gosh, they throw their hands up, what do I do? Is there a key to this? And of course, the FDA won't let us say, for this disease, use this product. They don't like that. So we had to come at this a different way. What we had to do was come up with systems where one program dealt with many, many diseases, okay? And you can't use the cure word, so we had to do it in a different way. So let's look at what we call the Basic Healthy Start Pack. There's 3 products in there. It has 245 nutrients. Many will be in the near future declared essential, so we're already putting them in there. But it also has the 90 essential nutrients, 16 minerals, 16 vitamins, 12 amino acids, 3 fatty acids in optimal amounts for perfect biochemical nutrition for 100 pounds of human flesh for a month. You give it to a 50-pound kid, it's a 2-month supply. Give it to a 30-pound kid, it's a 3-month supply. Give it to a 200-pound person, you need 2 of these per month. A 300-pound person, you need 3 per month, and so on. And this is the basic stuff. Now, I've essentially been doing it, not this form, but I've been doing it personally for 68 years. I haven't been sick in 68 years, never even had a cold. I've never had any surgery. I've never been on a prescription medication. My resting pulse without prescription, without a drug, without any medication, is 90 over 60. My resting pulse without any medication is 36. Now, it does spike when I get angry or upset. It'll spike to 39. But it's been that way since I was 18 years old when I was wrestling for the University of Missouri and playing football in high school for 4 years in lettering and football and wrestling. So this is our basic program. If you don't have a lot of money, this will cost you about $3 a day for the average person per 100 pounds of body weight. And this is what I've been doing, essentially the Healthy Start Pack. But let's say you have something like you're overweight by 50, 75, 100 pounds or more, 200 pounds, 300 pounds. You want the Healthy Weight Loss Pack. We have everything in there you need to give your body what it needs so your cravings go away, so your munchies go away. And we give your body what it likes so that it will give you everything it needs. It'll make what it can to keep you in the healthy weight range. And you'll lose anywhere from a half a pound to 2 pounds a day. And you'll never gain the weight back as long as you stay on this program. And then, of course, if you have diabetes, type 2, type 1, if you have anxiety attacks, panic attacks, narcolepsy, anything that has to do with blood sugar problems, hypoglycemia, reactive hypoglycemia, you want the Healthy Blood Sugar Pack, one of those per 100 pounds of body weight. And when you have diabetes, you just take your fasting blood sugar before you medicate yourself, and as your blood sugar drops, you just do what your doctor says. Reduce your medication. If your blood sugar goes up, you do what your doctor says. You take more medication, and you'll know when it's time to get off your medication. Anti-aging Healthy Body Pack, people who have wrinkles and age spots and just are tired all the time because they're in their 70s and 80s, you give them the Healthy Anti-Aging Pack, and the body's defenses can get rid of the age spots when you give it the raw materials to do that. Then, of course, we have the Healthy Brain and Heart Pack. The Healthy Brain and Heart Pack actually gives you everything you need to deal with over, I don't know, about 147 different diseases. And we're talking about Parkinson's disease, Lou Gehrig's disease, which is ALS, also MS, multiple sclerosis, Huntington's disease, Alzheimer's disease, and all the other dementias, also congestive heart failure, cardiomyopathy, heart disease, coronary artery disease, and a history of thrombotic stroke. The Healthy Brain and Heart Pack, one per 100 pounds of body weight. Okay, and then you have the Healthy Body Digestive Pack. You have reflux, belching, burping, bloating, gas, these sorts of things. You want the Healthy Digestive Pack. And there is no such thing as acid reflux. It really should be renamed lack of acid reflux, okay? Because you really don't have enough stomach acid, so yeast will grow in there, bacteria will grow in there, and they ferment carbohydrates and sugar, making gas and causing all these problems. So my suggestion is if you have reflux, don't take any of these PPIs, the proton pump inhibitors, so that you are going to make less stomach acid, because in 2, 3, 4, 5 years' time, you're going to have 15 diseases you didn't have before. They'll all be nutritional deficiency diseases. So you want the Healthy Digestive Pack, one per 100 pounds of body weight. Healthy Body Athletic Pack, if you're working hard in your trade and you're sweating, you want this one. If you're playing sports on the weekend or you're just kind of 2, 3 nights a week, you're going to the gym and running on the treadmill and working on the machines, you want to use the Healthy Body Athletic Pack. And also, if you have people in your family who are in school and they're playing sports, whether it's in grade school, junior high school, or university, or if they're trying out for the Olympic team, or you know professional football players, or even if you have somebody in the military, because the government does not give our military vitamins and minerals. They give them dry food, they give them canned food, but they do not get any vitamins and minerals. I have surveyed thousands of military personnel, many of whom have PTSD. They do not get any vitamins and minerals from the government. So if you have somebody you love who's in the military, I'd urge you to give them the Healthy Body Athletic Pack. It has all the minerals that are missing that result in the diseases that are diagnosed as PTSD, depression, manic depression, bipolar disease, and so on. And then Healthy Body Bone and Joint Pack. If you have arthritis, osteoporosis, bone-to-bone arthritis, osteopenia, osteoporosis, periodontal disease, which is osteoporosis of the face, you take the Healthy Bone and Joint Pack, and guess what happens? Your body has the ability to rebuild itself. Your body wants to heal itself, but you have to give it raw materials for that to happen. You cannot build a house without brick and mortar. You cannot build a house without roofing shingles. You cannot build a house without wood for framing and infrastructure. You need nails and screws and bolts and nuts. Okay, same way with our body. You may have the best genes in the world, but without the 90 essential nutrients, as they say in France, there ain't nothing going to happen. Okay? And so I just hope you remember the fact that we have less than 20% of the nutrients necessary in our baby foods. Our kids' generation will be the first generation in America that do not live as long as their parents. It's not a genetic thing. It's not destined. But if you don't supplement them, that prediction will come true. So I urge you to give everybody you know for birthdays, holidays, anytime a present's due, for graduations in schools and so forth, getting married, getting engaged, going out together on a regular basis, give them the 90 essential nutrients. Our babies will be born normal. People will live a long time. Your kids will outlive you, which is the way it's supposed to be. And I want to thank you for being such a great audience. Contact your Youngevity associate and find out how you get involved. Become part of the Youngevity Nation. And we're going to save America. Even more important than that, with this information, we can save the world. And God bless you.